apart and they fight.
So Jesus is being called the Lamb of God, shows us that his incarnation and passion and suffering and death is voluntary. That he was willing because of his love for us, understanding how terrible it is that we are separated from God, understanding how ugly it is that we feel guilty and when we sin and get depressed and all that kind of stuff, that he would sacrifice himself so that he could share his very life with us. Yesterday during the Orthros service, the Synaxarion, read that we use three senses, that God uses our three senses in this revelation of God. Theophany is a revelation of God. We also call it Epiphany because we light bulbs go off in our brains when we have understandings and make connections. Both of those things are happening in this feast. But God gave us this sense of hearing, and we heard the Father bear witness to his Son. Synaxarion says we saw the Holy Spirit, a very rare occurrence indeed, hover the way a dove hovers over Christ, and the sense of touch, because in the flesh, God allows us to touch him, to later be fed by him, to hear his word and to experience him. So the word of God took on flesh and voluntarily allowed himself to be joined with him. And we experience that in the blessing of the water. Now, what does it mean that we bless water? When we bless anything, we show it to be what God intends it to be. And water for us is life-giving. You cannot live without water. You get dehydrated, you dry up like a leaf. Although we yearn for those days of fallen leaves as we wiggle around in the snow and the ice, but it's not a good thing to crumble like a leaf, to be dehydrated. And we use this water to wash. So our sins and our hassles and our experiences and our busyness clouds up our ability to experience God more clearly. And when we wash away some beautiful stone that is encrusted in mud with water, we recognize what it is. But most importantly, when Christ stood in the Jordan and the waters of the Jordan touched him, he touched them, it, that touched us, that in that act, he reclaims this earth. He reclaims everything on it. Most importantly, he reclaims us to be as we were first created to be, in union with him, in support of him. And so he unites us in his body through touch and revelation. He unites us to himself, to the life of the Holy Trinity, which has no death. Death is ugly. Death is lousy. We don't like it. We don't want it. But he shares himself so that we can have that life that he intended for us. Imagine, brothers and sisters, that the waters that touched Jesus the waters of the Jordan, dissipated throughout this earth as it went into the oceans and evaporated and covers the whole earth. We're hearing the scientists, whatever their weathermen are called, all the time talking to us about how water circles the earth and everything is connected to each other, that this water makes us one with each other and one with God, that Christ makes us one with each other and one with God. He adopts us, he merges himself with us, he sends for us the Holy Spirit to live in us. We're baptized into him, we hear his word, we take the message of truth and life inside of ourselves. He gave us bread called flesh, which we cut from a loaf of what is called flesh bread. And when we cut the seal that we call the Lamb, which is God's voluntary gift of himself for us, we enter into the kingdom of heaven, we who are made the body of Christ, and share his very life with us. The bread and the wine are indeed the body and blood of Christ. They're the body and blood of Christ because they're received not in Cambridge, but in heaven. They're received not by fallen animals, but people who are baptized and made into Christ. The priest or bishop will pray, O Lord, send down thy Holy Spirit upon us and these gifts here spread forth, that they, the people and the bread and the wine, can be understood as already in the body of Christ, already sharing the kingdom of heaven that is now. The water that filled this font came from the sink that we wash the dishes in. And this water touched Christ in the Jordan, this same water. It's real. When I was a priest in New Kensington, Pennsylvania, a town of now 19,000 people, there was a factory just north of us in a place of Vandergrift, which is, of course, much smaller than the big city of New Kensington, that had a single factory left. Of all the industries, all gone, one factory left. And in this factory, they fuse aluminum to stainless steel for purposes of surgical instruments. So they wanted light, and they want the surgical steel to be antiseptic. So anyway, in this fusion process, there is a pollutant that is released, that is only released when you fuse aluminum and the stainless steel. And they measure the pollutants that come from that Vandergrift factory on the North Pole in the ice, long distance away. You see that smoke goes around the world. And the water that touched Christ in the Jordan has gone around the world. And the world belongs to Jesus because he took the world on himself. The Creator became an infant, and today we see him as an adult coming to save us and voluntarily offering himself. As Charlie pointed out last night, the innocent children who were massacred by Herod, as did John the Baptist, who bore witness to Christ and spoke the truth and lost his head, as do all of the martyrs and those who dedicate themselves to God and truth, even with the price of their lives. because we belong to him and because he belongs to us. We are little Christs and we are called to share his life, and so we bless water to see the water from our tap as water that touched Jesus. And when we take showers, we'd be smart to remember that that water also was touched by God when he took on flesh and stood in the Jordan. And when we drink water and when we cook, we would be smart to remember that God reveals himself to us, he's close to us, he loves us, and he brings us new starts, new beginnings, and new life. Through the prayers of our holy fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy upon us and save us.